My name is Jennifer Leaning, and I'm a professor at the Harvard School of Public Health and a member of the steering committee of the South Asia Institute. And it is my great pleasure to welcome today to talk to us and have us learn from his art, Basir Mahmood, who is an artist in residence at Lahore, but he is here on a fellowship from the South Asia Institute for emerging young artists from South Asia. And he was born in Lahore. He studied there at Beacon House National University. He received a fellowship for a year from the Akademie Schloss Solitude in Stuttgart, Germany. And he is very interested in the ways in which ideas are embedded in visuals. And he will have much to say about his ongoing preoccupation with the ways in which art leads to thinking and thinking can be best expressed through art. And that is going to be the role he plans to play increasingly, whether he's using physical art, visuals, films, or photographs. His artistic endeavor is emerging, as is his decision on which art form he prefers. And that's part of the fun of talking with emerging artists. They're in the process of discovering themselves. And there's been a lot of acclaim for what he's done so far. Since 2011, his works have been widely shown in the Garden of Eden, in the Palais de Tokyo in Paris, the Moscow International Biennial for Young Art in 2012 in Russia, the inaugural show of the Broad Museum at Michigan State University, Asia Pacific Triennial in Queensland, in Brisbane, and a number of other places, including the Cooper Gallery Project Space at Georgetown College in 2014. Several other places in Paris and Tokyo. You've traveled a lot in the last 3 or 4 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now here at Harvard, we're going to see, he's been here for a week, has a workshop tomorrow. This is where he's showing some of his art and engaging in a discussion with those of you in the room. So I really would like you to be alert and prepared to, you know, talk to him after we've heard from him. He's been shortlisted for the Abraj Group Art Prize for 2016, so we don't actually know the answer of that yet, do we? You've just been shortlisted.
Yeah. There are three artists been shortlisted, and one is already selected.
Uh-huh.
But that's when you become part of the show, and you get a prize money.
So you basically have hit a home run. In that.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
So that's
yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So,
yeah.
Can you let Basir begin to talk? We'll be sitting down. He will be using his computer, and at the end of this, or when he wants to engage us, we will then begin to have a discussion. And Basir, if you would like to have a people interrupt and ask you questions during this, let us know now. Or if you'd rather
yeah,
go
sure.
through it.
Yeah, sure. I have a presentation made how in an order how they were developed, and every work sort of plays speak about a time, the work which I made before getting into the university to study art within the university, and then also since 2011 when I started to travel. And you're right, I've been traveling to a lot of places, mostly in the context of artist residency and making work. So you're open to any time you could ask questions. I would like to sort of speak about, this is the slide I would like to start with. This is one of the drawing which I've made. I would like to also speak about the decision when I decided to become or try to become an artist. My brother and sister basically wanted to be an artist, and I had no interest whatsoever. And they both tried, they went into art schools, and then they somehow failed, they couldn't continue. And then I decided that, okay, I want to be an artist. And I went to my brother and I said, you know, I want to be an artist. He said, but you need to draw. And drawing was sort of like very first introduction what I had to art. And I think that is for most of the people. And when I started to draw, I sort of fell in love with it. You know, it was sort of my other face. I had no skill before, no interest whatsoever in this world. And first time I kind of found a language to sort of, you know, just to spend time with it. And I liked the time of, you know, sitting and looking at this visual and transforming it into through lines and shades. And then again, soon enough, I started to make sculptures, and that is before I went to the university. But then when I went to the university, I went to this university called Beacon Asian National University. It's a university which seems to, you know, they like to adopt like new methods, new techniques of, and this university sort of literally opened these doors of modern and contemporary art for me. You know, realizing that there are softer and other ways to say things and using these materials and mediums. There are certain decisions which I always take while making a work. One decision was that, you know, I want to shift all my hard work from my hand to my head. And then camera was sort of right answer to it. On the other side, I was also started to write, making films and writing theater performances. The kind of a theater performances I was writing, they were hard to do, sort a lot to the reality, all the people, characters, which were surrounding around me, I was bringing them into life, into theater performances. So I had sort of interest to reality as well, and sort of fictionalizing it, bringing it to life, making them into my characters. And every work, you know, I want to mention this in a very beginning, that now I always say that I'm working for this very last show of my life, where I want to put all my works together and see, and just walk through the exhibition and see where I have been. Because every work speak about the time, though it has larger context, lot to deal with my position as an artist, where I come from and where I have been traveled, but it also has some personal meanings, personal time, personal moments attached to it. Video, as you know, camera, I think moving image has some sort of an excitement attached to it, and I think that's how moving image sort of appears in the history of image making, probably. So I made this work, is called Man-Made. This is the very first video work which I made. And when you become an artist, when I feel always your work is always ahead of you. You always try to catch up. What I'm doing now, probably after 4 or 5 years, I would realize what I'm doing. So this work, I think now I started to understand this more, why I made this work at that time. This work called Man-Made, and it's a person who is wearing a three-piece suit for the very first time in his life. So it's 30 minutes of him transforming himself into somebody else. And this is the videos. I'll just show part of the videos, probably. I'm sorry, the video would be a bit slow because it's running a bit slow.
That's fine. So he knew you were videoing,
obviously. Yeah.
Yeah. And he was okay with that.
He was okay with that.
Maybe. Did you know why?
No.
Did
no.
you know why?
I myself didn't know why, honestly. Now when I trace back while making, I have other reasons, of course, to.
So you have other reasons?
Yeah. You know, I'm coming from this sort of background where I went to a school where they write English medium only on outside, but not inside. So they in Pakistan, I don't know whoever have been to this, a sort of class system exists in every field of life, and also with the language as well. I went to this art school called Beacon House, as I said, Beacon House National University. And a school, it's a very, very expensive school. I was only able to afford it because I got a scholarship to be there. And we were studying all these art through Western books. And we were, the sort of a language was sort of a problem for me in the beginning. I had to kind of learn this language to present my work
so
over there.
So you're telling him what to do here?
Yeah, we were sort of in a conversation. You could see like video quality is very bad, and there are some abruptions, like cuts as well. So I think I was, during the 4 years, I was sort of transforming myself as well while I was studying when I went to this university. I was forcefully or whatever, you know, whatever way, I wanted to learn this language at the same time. And I wanted to be able to present, able to speak about my work. So maybe, and the first time I started to, I understood this whole idea when one of my class fellow was talking to her driver, and they couldn't really communicate with each other. Even they were born in the same city, raised in the same city, but because of the class system which exists, there's a certain divide within the same society. So I thought, why not to sort of, and this, probably this is from the cities, it's developing, it's growing, this culture which we're adopting from here and there. So I thought, why not to capture it to the moment where it's just changing in a way. So it goes on and on, very completely, slowly changes.
You had to correct him sometimes about what to put on.
He was asking me about questions. He had seen his son wearing it on his wedding. So you could imagine how special this suit is somehow in the society. Mm-hmm. And he speaks about in a larger context. He speaks about our history as well and the influence of cultures which comes came to Pakistan.
So I've seen a picture of him when he's finished. Yeah. You have the picture where he's all done. The last thing we saw, his tie was still not working very well.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Is that how you left it, or did you figure that was close enough to perfect? Or did you
I didn't want it to correct it, but I wanted the things are all somehow there.
So that's all there.
So did you have a personal relationship with him before this, or?
No, I this is the first time I met him.
So and how did you get him to agree to do this? I'm just curious.
I've asked, like, there's this person who works at the university where I was, and I asked him if there could be somebody who would be, who have never wore this suit. Mm-hmm. And I was lucky enough to find him. And he was sort of excited as well, but sort of unsure in the middle. You could see on his face that probably in the middle he realized he made a mistake to become part of the work. I don't know.
How did you introduce it to him?
What do you mean?
How did you tell him what you wanted him to do?
I just initially told him that, you know, this is the suit and he has to wear it, and I'm sitting behind the camera. And I myself didn't know what I want to achieve myself. So there's always this confusion conversation between me and him, and I just wanted him to go. Like, just try him, and at the same time, I wanted to capture those moments when he's sort of unsure about things.
Why did you elect to keep the conversation up? Because you're telling us a lot of the conversation, but the video itself doesn't have that conversation.
Yeah, that's, you know, when I, first time I
don't
showed...
Don't go on to another one, because that's going to confuse us. Let's look at this man who is now seated, if you have a good photograph of him, and we can get some questions on him.
Yeah.
It's clear that people are very interested.
Okay.
Because I feel like there's something about the video, where he's like taken his clothes off or something extremely slightly disturbing, because for me at least, because of the vulnerability of
the fact that
he
gets seen.
Start that sentence again, if you don't mind.
When I was looking at the video, there's something extremely vulnerable about his position,
mm-hmm.
because he's taking his clothes off, and the uncertainty and knowing the context, and of course clearly there are markers of his identity before he takes his clothes off, so you can tell tell that this is so. I was just wondering why the conversation, whether the decision was it to heighten the feeling of discomfort for the viewer, because or whether to kind of remove the interaction remove the interaction that you were also a viewer looking at him while doing it. I'm just very curious as to.
You know, when I first time showed this work to my teacher, when I made this work, they said, you know, when you're a student, you're always unsure, always this discussion sort of shift your practice. And so we had this discussion, should I keep this conversation or not, what to do. I was sort of interested that he becomes this general person, not to have an identity in that way, not become one individual. But at the same time, if I make this work now, probably I keep his voice. Probably I keep his character. So this is a work, as I said, I made like 6 years back when I had no idea whatsoever how video works, and you see this, there's some problems as well within the work. But maybe if I have to redo the work, probably I keep the conversation. Probably I keep his character in the work.
Can I ask one more follow-up question?
Sure.
The other thing that the video reminds me of is the colonial tradition of photographing,
yes.
Especially because he enters with a kind of garb. He's against a white background of a studio, and obviously the end of the transformation kind of disturbs that, and he's seated. And I'm also thinking of Pushpamala's N's work, who also kind of plays around with that genre of photography. So I was just wondering whether you had that in mind, of that kind of photo documentation, those colonial practices, whether those were things
I had this in mind. The history I use it in the recent time. When you ask people that part of the world, I think you're very much familiar. When you ask them, I'll take your photograph, they always go static. And they think that the camera would take time. And they look at it. And I wanted to sort of capture this as well. So I asked him that I'll take your photograph in the other video you see. I'll take your photograph, just sit there for as much as long. And then I have these little details. You could see he's breathing. And slowly he's sort of losing his self as well, because he's getting tired a bit as well. So there are these little details also becomes part of the work as well.
I was wondering if at the end of it you had a chance to talk to him about what he experienced as he transformed from never having worn a suit to come to this place of wearing a suit, and what that did to him, and you know, whether he was able to speak to any of that.
Yeah, he was excited, and he asked me to give me a photograph of him wearing the suit at the end, which I did. He wanted to, I photographed him and I gave him the print as well. And then he became also later became part of my other film as well. So yeah, we have this sort of a relationship now. And he's always excited because I have this work on my website and I have shown it some other countries. So I tell him about these things. So he's sort of, I think it excites him to the point.
One more question? I was just going to ask almost the same question. And also thinking about how in visual art, there's a kind of a dialogue that goes on between the person who is, quote, observed and the observer. And by engaging him in that dialogue, either afterwards, what was this like for you? What would you suggest for other people? That might be another, those are just some thoughts I had about it.
I don't know, I didn't understand the question, but you know, there's...
let's get it clear. So exactly what were you asking him?
I was going to pick up on this question of what was the experience like for him, and you said you'd continued. And it started me thinking about the kind of dialogue that goes on between a photographer and an artist and the person that you are depicting. And so I was wondering if you had thoughts about that as well.
Do you feel good, as did I, that he did further engage this man in other art?
Yes.
Because there is something about this, if he said no, there's something about this that has been alienating and disturbing, which I remember you thinking. Okay. Do you understand what we're saying?
Yeah. And I'll also, you know, there's always this conversation which I have with my work as well. You know, you make your work and you become aware of your work. Mm-hmm. It tells you, and this is how you develop. And I think some of these questions which you are asking, I have answered them in some of my other later works as well, where I became sort of very honest about it, that what is the position of an artist and how could I tell somebody to do certain things. And I have a chance once, and I work with real people since this work. I started to work with real people, and sometime most of the time I go with the complete narrative, how I want them to perform and all of it. But then sometimes they are not interested in acting, and that becomes part of my work. They are completely uninterested. And there's this very strange conversation builds from there, where they are acting, but you could feel that they are not part of my film that way. And that I have also realized later when I when I was in London at this residency where I guestworks, I tried to make a work. I got very ambitious and I had some funding, so I got like professional actors to play into my film. And then I realized they were doing exactly the same how I wanted them to do. And that's how the work became very, very boring. Because they were doing exactly how I am perceiving, how I wanted them to do. But here, you could see, you could obviously draw some sort of a parameter as you frame the structure, how you wanted, what you want to look at. But still, at the same time, you cannot control it. You know, it's because they are real people. They have other characters to play. And they are not comfortable with the camera. Some of the people I have worked, which I'll show you in the later videos, some of them have faced the camera for the very first time in their life. And you could literally see that they do not want to be there. So that's how they sort of deny my structure, my film at the same time. That's how it becomes part of my work, let's say.
So let's move on. It's great. Though.
I'm glad that on the very first work, there are a lot of questions started to appear. So there's, and then you know later more understanding started to appear into my work, into my films. This is the work which I made. It's a portrait of my father. My father had me when he was 45, and so literally when I was growing younger and stronger, I saw him getting older and weaker. And I still live with my parents who are like old, and I'm the only one who live with them. So I was the youngest child in the family. So there are a lot of things which I do for them, like dialing a number or writing something or even doing this act with you threading this needle. And I wanted to sort of speak about this very personal relationship which I have with them. And strange enough, this work came from a very different point of view when I was reading about conceptual art. The very first definition I read about conceptual art was, conceptual art is about it's about the idea, but not really about the execution. It's about the idea-led sort of a practice, which I now perceive. So I thought probably he would do this act, which he used to do. He has this idea what to do, but he cannot somehow do it anymore. I can show it. And there are also sort of, as I said, another layers to the work as well.
What are you going to show us in trying?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Did he used to be a tailor?
No.
But he used to be able to thread needles.
Yeah, of course. I mean, but because of his age, probably.
Did he know you were filming him?
Yeah, yeah. He did it for 10 minutes, and I think after 10 minutes he could do it, but that wasn't of my interest, so I just took the first 2 minutes, because I think they speak about well about. And also, as I said, there are other reasons to make this work, and now as I'm working as an artist, so I always try to find out, go back into my past and see, what was it in me that I became artist and why I think of all these ideas. Not many people know that my father was a poet. He used to write these 2 lines in a newspaper. Every afternoon the newspapers would come and he would write like 2 lines. Those 2 lines would be about the very current situation of the country or whatever he observed and everything. So we would go after every dinner, we would go for a walk. And he would make these 2 lines. So I was like very small. And I remember him going to wherever we would go or sit, he would be making those 2 lines. And that was probably the strongest memory I had as a child of seeing this poet in a process, making these 2 lines. And I was sort of, always looking at him. I didn't know what he was doing, but he was, and I think I have now when I read his poetry, I have taken few things from his practice somehow directly or indirectly. I think my father only went to school till the school, he didn't study much. And so whatever he was, the poetry he was writing, it was very simple vocabulary which he was using. And he was directly responding to what he was seeing. So probably that also I think became part in my practice. I talk about very simple things. not a very complex ideas. It's very much there. And at the same time, you know, in this work also gave me this idea, you know, whatever is personal, somehow on some level have a tendency to become public. It amazes me how people sort of respond to the work, see the work, and they sometimes speak about their grandparents, their own self or somebody else, their own experiences. Yeah.
So I have a question. Was your father upset that it took him this long?
No, he do not like this work because he always say that, you know, we need to do it again because his face is not appearing properly. So that's his take. He wants to be visible in this work. But I always try to convince him, you know, it wasn't about that, but yes. But he's for my parents also, it's a surprise for them. You know, it's very hard for me to tell them what I really do to my family.
I'm sure this made it harder.
Right? Yeah, maybe, probably. And then this work, it's a continuation of the work which I made before called Man-Made. You know, Man-Made, there's one person changing clothes. Then I wanted to see sort of larger gatherings where people could, you know, wanted to see more possibilities of the same work. And this is a work called Landa Bazaar. And it's a market next to the station, next to the Lahore railway station. It's a huge market where all these secondhand clothes would come from different countries and people go and try out clothes. And everybody's trying on the street. It's a huge market. And interesting enough, it's called Landa Bazaar because of London, maybe because of the history we had. And London is still by far, still now the most popular city in Pakistan. And now the clothes come from all these different places. And I found this place very interesting, you know. I thought, you know, it's an interesting point where clothes from one, it's a meeting point of two societies where clothes from one society and people from the other society go and, you know, try out these clothes and merge together. And I slowed down the sound and the visual of it. And the background sound of the market sound sort of became a soundtrack for their performance. Sorry. As I said earlier, you know, in my practice, there are a lot of decisions which I take what I had other experiences work. In this work, I look at it as a performance because I had this background in theater. And also I wanted to treat the video just as a painting. So you see, because it's a colorful market, and I thought it would be nice to completely, you see these flat colors emerging, and then slowly you have this activity going on. It's a loud market because of traffic, and there's so many people. This is a rickshaw sound. I don't know if you are familiar with it, this tuk-tuk sound in the background. If there are any questions, then I could go further. Next one. And then thereon, then I looked at other activities where there are more people, more gatherings, and I think since this Landa Bazaar work, I got interested into real-time activities, things which were already there, and I'll just go there and observe them. And I also become, I was slowly probably with my practice, I'm becoming more of a viewer. I just go and see things if they already have something already to engage me and some idea already exists, then I try to sort of bring it into my work. And this is a call, I am on the other side, you are on the other. It's a, the work was shot in, it's a border between Pakistan and India. It's called Wagah Border. And it's a performance every evening where thousands of people gather. In the middle, there's a army from both sides. They have, it's a choreographed performance they do. And the crowd from both sides, they just cheer, they support their sort of their people, their armies. And I was just sort of, when I went there, later, again, as an artist, things appear to be, you have fresh eye again to look at it. I went there as a child, as a kid, a lot of time, but when I went there later, I realized that there is not really a way to look at this whole activity from a third point of view. There's always only there two point of view. Physically, you have to take one side in order to experience this. So I thought, how could I create a third viewer into this work? And so the video which you see, it was installed at this Charger Biennale. So physically also, when you go enter into this space, there will be two videos very closer to each other. So in order to experience this one side, you have to physically place yourself to the other side. To one side, you have to kind of own this one group of people. And I wanted my viewer to become sort of a performer for me and to see how they shift these sides while experiencing the work. Then, as I said, 2011 was a time when I got an opportunity to be in Germany to on a residency for 1 year. And when I had a lot of ideas, I was very excited to be there. But when I went there, I literally could not really make any work. And that was a time, 2011 was a time when I really haven't produced no work. Maybe because I was in a different context, I couldn't really understand, because I was always playing with the context. I was always, because I had the issues I was dealing with, they were known to me. And then when I was sort of placed in a foreign context, I couldn't really grasp and understand what to work on. And that was a sort of really difficult time for me. So I was probably not making a work, but I was making myself. I was experiencing a lot of things. I was experiencing the art. And I was also sort of this question came and later into these works, which I could answer them, that how do I position myself while making a work? How do I position myself into a foreign context, into my own context? So then my position became more important than the subject I was looking at. So I had no answer, so I thought probably if I'm not making a work, maybe the time I'm living is more as an artist, because I was living with 50 other artists, musician, poet into this context, and we were having these wonderful discussions all the time. And that was the first time I bought a camera, so I was asking everybody over a tea. It's called a tea project, where I was inviting them over a tea for me, and we'll have like all these conversations. So, and in the end, I'll take their photographs. So I initially planned that I'll write probably a book about it, but maybe I do it in the future, I don't know. I have all these conversation documented. So these were like sort of portrait, and slowly the projects evolved, and this is the person I met the first and the last time on the table, and he came to me. He said, can I have a tea with you? Somebody told me. I said, why not? Let's have a discussion. And he appeared to be a very interesting person. We had this discussion in the end, I take his photograph. And it was interesting also because of this project, I got to know a lot more people. There are around 40 to 50 photographs. And I was every day meeting these new people, wonderful, exciting people, have different stories to tell. And I thought probably those stories could become part of my work on, because I wanted to make work, but I had no other reason to make work. I was completely sort of stuck at that time. And then I went to this other residency in Bodrum, Turkey. And over there I also went, it was a wonderful hotel, sort of a very big, huge hotel, where, before me there was some president was staying. So you could imagine the kind of a place it was, very luxurious. And I don't know why they had this idea that they could, artists need comfort or place like this to, I don't know. I went there and I thought, okay, if there's nothing to inspire me, probably there's something wrong with me now. Maybe I'm not an artist anymore. You know, this guilt is always with me, because my brother and sister, I always felt they were more talented than me. And why am I, practicing all of it? But anyways, so when I went to Turkey, and I was thinking about, what to do, because I only had 1 month. So one early morning when I woke up and I went outside to the beach, where normally you see all these, white people having sun, I saw fishermen over there. In the middle of all these hotels, there were fishermen over there, and not all many, but there were some. So I started to sort of ask people, different people about, who are these people, what are they doing and everything. And I got to know that this place was known for fishermen before. And I thought, okay, probably I should make work about a profession which is not there anymore, or maybe which is disappearing in that way. But what do I do? So I thought probably I should do a conversation between a man and a sea. Somehow I responded through a work. And then I resolved this work by making this video. It's called A Message to the Sea. There's no video. I'm sorry, I'm really bad at this. How do you, can I play like VLC? You have it? Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. You want to see a dance.
Okay. So it ends somewhere. So, and again, as I mentioned, you know, this constant conversation is between me and my work, and it's important when you make a work, you deny it at some time to think about more possibilities to make a work. And I think in this case, when I made this work, I was thinking about, I'm talking about a big idea. I'm talking about as big as sea. So I thought of, you know, maybe I should think about an individual, talk about one person probably. You know, who were those people? What were their identities and all? And then I met this person who was a fisherman before, but now he was renovating his house. And I asked him if I could visit his house, and he said he's leaving for a week to his take his wife back or something like this. And I asked him if I could stay in his house when he's away. And he was very nice enough that he said, okay, his house is open and things like that. When I was doing theater performances, there was this exercise I used to do as an actor that if I act like you, for the next 30 minutes, I could be you, you know. There would be more possibilities I will have to become you. And when I went to his place, I thought, okay, what if I become him into his personal space, into his small room? And as him, and I started to open his very personal objects, his very personal things, and I started to just, I opened those very small things which I had packed and just very respectfully put them on floor and just photographed them. And this work is called No Lands for a Fisherman. It was sort of a counter dialogue that probably as a fisherman, they do not need a land. And I wanted to sort of create his very personal landscape through that work. kind of. And so it's like six photographs which I took of his very personal sort of objects. Yeah. And then this is another work. It's called In a Move to the Better Side. When I was going to Germany, I was 26. When I was 26, and that was the first time I was leaving Pakistan. And most of the family invited me to dinner before I leave, my extended family. And it was so funny to have all these reactions and their perception where I was going. I think all of them were saying I should never come back. Even my cousin said, if you get out of the airport, just throw your passport and just run away, things like that. And I had this expectation, and people were telling me about this, this better side of the world. And they themselves, most of them have never really gone. They were all telling me all these stories. And I had this sort of expectations, I don't know where I am going, and things like that. So I started to think about this whole disposition, where am I going, and why everybody thinks like that. And most of the people do think like that, this is the better side of the world. And when I went to Germany, I read this news. There were 21 men wanted to travel to Europe illegally. And they were hiding themselves into a container, and the container got lost on the way. And they were died out of suffocation. And I thought of, that's what I said, I started to position myself after Germany. And I thought there were probably 22 men. I included myself into them. And I thought maybe I arrived and they couldn't reach across. And so I started to think about, how would I make this work? So when I went to Japan, I went to the city where a small town which was all developing, you walk into the street and you would see here people constructing their houses and building new houses. So I thought, okay, maybe it's the best place to make a work for that. So I resolved around making a work. I approached this whole idea of this whole event in a completely opposite way. One decision was that I'll keep this distance which I had from the actual event. I wasn't there. So there's always, you see these people, but you don't really see their faces. So I am also sort of standing on a distance. And also to also opposite all this the idea of suffocation with the openness. And the work I made is a very calm, very, let me. When I made this work, I was thinking about what really made the move, why. I was thinking about probably, was it the object who was moving them, or was it their idea or their hope that this object would take them to the better side? And I thought, why not that they construct this object container-like shape within the film as they're constructing their hope or their ideas or something like this. And again, the viewer moves with them. So they even if they are trying, there's physical effort even in the work they're making, but they still stay within the frame. So the next few minutes, it stays there. They keep on trying it, and they stay in the middle. It just goes on within
that.
Like that, yes. Doesn't really end anywhere.
Could you just stop for a second there? Does anybody else wonder what the actual shape of this is? Is it just one side, or what's behind it? Is it just that one wall, or is it a whole thing?
It's a whole thing.
Oh.
Yeah, that's why it was quite heavy also to carry.
Because my thought was, well, why don't they just flip it like a table? And then I realized there has to be some other reason this is so difficult. You wanted that impression.
I wanted it to be heavy. I wanted it to be heavy. First, when we did it for first two times, I realized it's probably not that heavy. They said, "Oh, we'll do it. You know, just take in one floor." But when they had to sort of do it as a ritual, push, place it, and then pick it up. Then it got tiring, and I wanted that. Yeah, I wanted it to be.
Wait, I have a question. Does your frame?
I think we need a microphone. Only, you know.
Sure. So I'm wondering if your frame always centers the box, or does towards the end the box actually kind of exits the frame? And the reason I'm asking, I'm just thinking of the previous piece that you showed where the fisherman and the boat, I think that was very provocative because it leaves the audience with this thought that who's going to get that boat? You know, is it going to come back or is there someone on the other side, right? And so there's that mystery, and as you were talking about, the third point of view comes into it. And here I'm wondering if there was that same sort of intention for the viewer to think about where does this box go if it was removed from the frame of this.
Yeah, it is not removed. I think it stays there, and I want this work to be continuously on the loop. It plays on the loop. So the object stays always in the middle. All these efforts are sort of effortless. The object's always is with the viewer. And we are looking at a work not physically moving, but at the same time. I always like to place this work on a reflected surface. So it's kind of, you know, when you're standing on a sand, it moves somehow when on the beach somehow. I wanted to sort of create that feeling that it somehow moves you, even though if you're static and you know that they, whatever their physical effort is just meaningless because you as a person standing on the distance, looking at this activity and not physically a part of it, and just looking at from a distance and just seeing what are they doing, you know, just trying to understand how much effort it takes to carry. Again, this distance I wanted to keep, which I probably had with the actual event. And then again, you know, earlier we were asking about, you know, how much, probably the question I heard, you know, how much power you have as a filmmaker or a video artist to make people perform. And I think here in this work, all my, what I really wanted the work to be, it didn't appear like that. But the failure somehow became part of the work. I asked this person if he could, his name is Rafiq, he works at the university where I am. I asked him if we could gather his relatives. When I went to Pakistan, you know, after all this travel, traveling, I think the best thing it gives you to you is the sense of comparison. You start to compare things. And when I went back to Pakistan, I started to notice even my family, I think with a very fresh eye, my people, everybody. And I became sort of this silent viewer and outsider in my own society. So I was started to observe the little things, what they were doing, why they are acting in a, behaving in a certain way. And I thought, probably I make a sketch where I gather these people and I go with my camera and I shoot. And I asked this person to choreograph because I thought his people would be, they would be more comfortable working with him. But the minute I went there with the camera, the whole structure got break. They were not comfortable me being there. And you could see, I think, within the film, the kind of a structure which I wanted to make sort of broke within the film. Sorry. And all these takes which I did, I decided not to take them out. So there's also a lot of repetition also within the acts. If we go to the next.
Sure.
Yeah. We'll have to manage the time, so I'm... And then I also did like some of the photographs also, just capturing those moments, gestures. And they are not included, but I made some of the other works as well, where I came with the, went even more with the, you know, structured film. And I brought people really from, like, I started to divide with different professions. I want to make one work with all the doctors in it, like a lab, but it's very expensive to hire them. You know, I'm having difficult time to work with them. You know, and then I work with people
they
who
won't
are
volunteer. You have to pay them.
Yeah, I have to pay them. Okay. I think I'll have to. They do not have time.
Right.
So, and then I work with also some of the minorities, like Christian community, which is very like 1.8% in Pakistan. So I work with them also. I work with the people who work in a very minimum wage, like they are known to be like labor with unskilled labor. They do not have any skill, but you ask them whatever you want them to do. So they mostly carry stuff. So I thought if I probably I pay them the same amount and just ask them to work with my film. And you see in those films that they are not interested in my film at all. They are somewhere else. They are thinking about something else. And I thought, you know, there's some of these sketches, I think. And then this work, it's 2014, it's a kind of a recent work. I went to Brazil, I got this award on from Video Brazil on the work, My Father work. And I got this award to go back to Brazil to work there for 3 months. And I met this other artist, Bakare Diallo. He was also going to the same place. So we decided that we'll go to the same place in Brazil. And then we were talking about different possibilities if we could do sort of collaboration and all. Then I had my flight from Doha. And when I went to Doha, I got this email that his plane got crashed in Mali and he died. And I was like right in the middle of the airport. I took one flight and I had to take the other. To be honest, I think art became completely secondary for me at that time. You know, I was thinking about so many other things. You know, it could have been me, and I was like right in the middle. And I took a flight somehow because I had to go somewhere, and I went there, and I was the first person to arrive in that house where they were preparing for these other residence houses also to arrive. And I was thinking about how am I going to make work? What am I going to do? And then after some time when I settled down, I thought probably I have started making work when I was there. And I think when this news came to me, I think that was the time when I started making work. And then I resolved it into this video work which I made. So let me explain. This on the left side, you see, there's a one day which I tried to capture. You know, when I was very young, I used to think how the next day would be look like when I die. You know, how the people would hear about my news of my death. You know, things like this, and how the next day, because I was just curious about the day, the next day. And I made this work sort of in a memory of two artists, me and Bakare. So maybe this work would be more strong when I die, you know. So maybe it's in a memory of myself as well. And on one side, you see this whole day slowly passing by, start from early morning till it goes, till the evening. And on the other side, and within this video, there's these workers within that house who are preparing the house for these other residents to arrive. So they are preparing for somebody who would never arrive. And on this other side, this side, all these people who are working this house, I asked them to become my actors, and I asked them to look at a distance and not to blink their eyes. So when you do not blink, you start to tear, of course. So I'll have to forward. It's a long book. It's around 22 minutes. So slowly, it you know, start. They start to tear with time. You know, this work I think was the most difficult for work for me to make. Because I think I was emotionally disturbed. I had a lot, and I don't know, strange enough, while making this work, I got this infection into my eyes, where I was staring as well while making a work. Very strange, maybe because of the weather or I was staying there. So it goes like till the evening, it goes. And then in Pakistan, I'm making like...
We have about, what, 10 more minutes?
Yeah, I just have two more works. Very quickly, I'll show them. They're quick to explain. They're not... I'm recently trying to escape out of video. I think I should do something else and think about other possibilities. Again, I always end up making video somehow. This is a work which... it's just a photograph which I make. It's a... there's a holy water that comes from Makkah. It's called Ab-e Zamzam, and when people go to Kaaba, they bring it into the bottles, and then they further divide it into small bottles, and those bottles goes into extended family or to friends, and when they arrive to you, you further divide them into small portions for everybody. So my mother asked me to stand and drink and pray, you know, things like that. So I thought this water starts off for me and then slowly it breaks into small portions and it has arrived to me. So I just put this water in front of me, I just photograph it before drinking. And then write this small narrative. This is the last work which I have made. It's called Missing Letters. These are the, there's this department as the post office in Pakistan. It's called Return Letter Office. In the British era, I used to call Dead Letters Office. And all these letters which are undelivered, sometimes the system is not efficient or they have some writing issues or whatever, somebody refused to take it, they keep it for 1 month and eventually they burn it. So I somehow got hold on these ashes and I took those ashes and burned them to the point where they cannot be burned anymore. And I was thinking about, while making this, while getting these ashes and why I got it, I was thinking about this missing persons issue, which is very sort of known in Pakistan. There are these people who go missing because of the authorities or whoever just take them away. And even though when they appear on court after some time, the media still refer to them as missing persons, even they are found. So I thought even they are found, they are missing. I thought, so I was thinking about all of that while making this, collecting these ashes and burning them. Even though I burn these ashes, but they still sort of carry all those texts or messages or whatever people wanted to sort of send to each other that way. Yes.
Can you show us any, can you get us a bigger picture of it?
It's completely black, I'm sorry. Yeah. It's supposed to be, it's supposed to be like this, just on a corner, just these ashes of these letters.
Okay, let's pause there with that. That's actually sort of a beautiful image. And some discussion, some thought. Yes, please, use the microphone.
Thank you. That was really interesting. And I have lots of questions, but I'm going to ask one and then maybe others can join in. There are two things that I was really curious about. One is that I'm not saying that I'm curious about the kind of, first of all, it's very masculine. The bodies are, the spaces are masculine, which I'm not saying that they have to be women. That's not my question. My question is then, what is interesting about that relationship, that, or, you know, the male body and the way in which, at one point, it's really far away, like the fisherman, and sometimes it's really close, where, you know, like in the fathers. But at the same time, it's not about the individual body necessarily, because it's not that we're seeing distinct faces and identities. We're really seeing almost to the point of like seeing the texture of the skin, or like seeing the body from a complete distance where it's not recognizable. So that this question of distance in the body is, I was hoping you could talk a little more about.
Yeah. There is, there recently somebody was this magazine, somebody was interviewing, and interesting enough that she came up with these two questions. She was interviewing me before this work, Two Eyes Not to Blink, where the people are crying. And she said, you always have people in your work. And I said, yes, the work has to do somehow with an activity, some individual. And she said, you always work with men. They're always, most of the time, men in your work. And to be honest, I never thought of these things before. And now, since then, I started to think about all these things. You know, why not their movement? Thank God, they're again. Later, I made this work where women. But that's true. I think I'm not interested in human bodies, using them directly into the work. But I genuinely probably interested what human do. I'm interested in an activity, an event which takes place. I'm interested in narratives, a story. Maybe that comes from my background in writing theater or video films. I was working with activities, real events, and I'm bringing them on stage. And I think that's how these people and activity sort of comes always into my work. Even if even if they are not people directly, but is somehow their traces in the work. Yeah.
I'm a Korean. Recently, I presented my work at the Yenching Institute. It's about those ashes and real human remains were excavated at the airport, mass burial, and they are burned, cremated, and the ashes will be kept in a small jar and kept in the public ossuary, public kind of funeral house. And I was keep working on this, how this, the people who disappeared 60 years ago returned as a, these remains, materials, and how they become changed, transformed into persons with their names and their address and families. And finally, they were nothing in the past. They were lost, but now they turn into a real person and family member, and also historical kind of person. So they become a public. This whole process are very much ritualized.
Yeah.
I think all your work had very constant theme of this ritualization or ritualization of this humanity and maybe bodies and also activities.
Yeah.
Particularly, I like that the needle is placed in the center, unmoved. And also this fisherman standing in the right middle of space, your screen, and he doesn't move, just like a needle. I want to, and these ashes, it's a real, it's a real thing, right? And they are now placed in the kind of space, totally different space. So their reality has been transformed into something different. And I really don't know how to, name it. So would you, just two things in my question. Why do you put this needle and this fisherman unmoved and standing in the center? It's like a dividing section, this side or the other side. Because your first slide or video shows these two sections, two different activities. Finally, they kind of become one at the end. And I don't know how to name these ashes. Do they have a real name, or it doesn't matter?
You're asking if to him they have meaning.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
Because to you they have a meaning.
No, I just ask myself as a kind of viewer, or maybe participant of your art project.
I think if I have to, I think I'm a storyteller somehow. And I think all artists are somehow, they're telling stories. And all works are fictionalized. All artworks are fiction. Even though if you're working with core reality, you always have to fictionalize it to take it from one place to the other, even to exhibit. So probably all works are lie for me. And you construct that lie in a way that it becomes believable. And you said about needle and this fisherman. You know, there's always these visual decisions which you take. Who do you want to give power and who do you want to give second power or things like that. By placing them in a center, they become this constant power, but at the same time, after a while, you ignore them and you think about other activity because they are constant, they are static at one place. So your attention after a while shifts from one to the other activities, but keeping their presence, their strong presence in mind. So that's how probably I divide power within the same visual in that way.
Yes. I think your point about the ritualization of the activity is very important. And it links to his decision to stand away from it so that you see it somewhat differently. But it still has in it the narrative that there is something going on, but you're being forced to see it differently. And it's, one can get impatient watching this, and then when you relax, it becomes
a very
kind of experience.
Yeah, it's a very, your images and this movement, slow movement, invite us to engage in that situation. I think that's the kind of part of ritualization. Mm-hmm. That's what I meant. Mm-hmm. And I'm very satisfied with your answer to my question, placing the needle and the fisherman in the center of the screen, unmoved. You kind of fixing the frame, but we, and also maybe the figures in the screen moves, and that creates whole living and mentalizing.
That's all right.
We understand, because I think a number of us have that same feeling. It's a really good observation. Two more, how much time do we have? One more. There are some other hands, some thoughts. You had many questions. You have more questions. Great, thank you. We're going to need a microphone, please.
I just had a question about, I'm sorry we came in late, but I just had a question. I just had a question about, you know, I was fascinated by your story about the fisherman and going and staying in his home and then taking pictures of his personal objects and then the people that you were filming later, the ones who were passing the fruit. And I'm sorry if I missed some of the context earlier, but how do they respond? How do the people who you are, in a way, focusing on or objectifying in a way, or they become your subjects? How do they respond to the art? What is their what is their involvement in it aside from just you're telling them what to do or you're using their objects? But what is their relationship to the art that you make?
They, I have very, very difficult time explaining them what I do. I think even to my family, explaining them what I do, it's very difficult. To them, it's they're just not interested. I try to convince them sometime. I would love to work with like larger, really huge gathering of 100 or 200 people when this whole activity goes beyond my control. Not everybody I could control. I would love to do that. But it's harder to convince them and bring them together. The work you are referring to, thank you for coming. In this, I had the person who is asking them to do certain thing. He was sort of an architect of the work. He made them do certain things. So we sit together before that, and he said, okay, we'll maybe ask them to come, and they do this and that and things like that. And I wanted to just become a viewer, an observer, just with my camera. But then there are more other interesting things started to happen, and I thought, okay, I'll go with the flow. And then I also made some of the sketches where I send one of the cameramen, who is also from one of those people, I just gave them the camera. I funded that event, and I said, just bring me the footage. So in that footage, they are much more relaxed, because I am not, an alien figure is not involved, you know. They are much more comfortable in that way. So there are different possibilities I'm just trying to see within my work. One part is that I just observed, and the other part is that whatever I observed, I transformed that into these fictionalized sort of narratives and activity, as you see in this work or before that. Yeah.
So we're going to have to bring this to an end. Could you say just a couple of words about what you think you're going to be doing next?
That's very important question for me. I always think about it. You know, there's the best part and the worst part of my practice probably is that I'm not sure what I'll be doing next. I like to believe in, I think, most of these work. The work was, I think, already there. I just became the first viewer. I think the fisherman's work, which you see, I think the whole work, the whole narrative was there already. I just happened to be there and just put them into words, maybe. So you always look for inspiration. You always look for things. And there's so much which inspires you, so much which you like, but not everything becomes a work. I like things to disturb me twice. If they disturb me once, okay, I stay with them. But if they disturb me twice and I think that they could become a work, then I give them attention to bring them to life and make the work. And I make very few. I make like two or one work a year because I make a lot of sketches. I always make work, but again, I take time to have even enough confidence to bring them to life or to show them or things like that. So it's always this conversation which I do with myself. And the other things which I'm sort of pursuing, I'm more interested in ideas than the visuals, than the images. And that's probably maybe my strength or my interest is. Sometimes I just think about a work and that's amazing. But when I realize the work, when I give visual to my idea, it just became very ordinary. And I think my ideas are much more important than my visuals. But again, you have to depend on something to communicate, to talk about. I don't want to become a writer again, but maybe, I don't know, I have to find somewhere in the middle. So this is a struggle which I'm going through.
Well, thank you. Yeah. I think we'll remember that favorite phrase that you really begin to hone in when something disturbs you twice. Mm-hmm. I think that is very translatable to a lot of our work. What you're describing as your journey is it's pretty wonderful and very brave, and we are delighted to participate with you in part of the way, along the way.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing it with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.